with a focus on this overall status of where we are. I want to say a couple things though before I get started, because I've gotten some input already about where are we, and are we locking in, and are the aspects of how we're looking at where we're going to go, just based upon what we know today. The you will get a discussion about what we call the flexible plan. We're going to go find and talk about, is it a plan? It's a plan, but it's not a baked plan that has no flexibility. The operative word is flexible. And so every year, it may not be something that we talk about, every year we create a look and view of the future based upon what we know. And we actually do multiple updates and thinking and scenario. That's planning. That's long-term strategic planning, but it does not lock us into any particular thing. It is just a logical plan to look at the technology again and the things that we know today and what that view might look like going forward. But as we've seen over even the last decade, a lot of things have changed. Renewables and their pricing and their availability and interest in the market has expanded. And we didn't see what we have today in 2018. If you asked us what the market would look like back in 2008, we wouldn't have been able to predict all the advances that have come along. We wouldn't have even been able to predict that iPhones would look and work and operate the way they do. And so, again, we are thoughtful. We are creating plans and activities that we can actually attain and apply. And we want to have dialogue. The other thing, I'll just start again and make sure that it's clear, we are going to go around the community to talk about what are we thinking, wanting to hear back from everyone, what do you think about that, what are the real implications of things as we move forward, and what else do we need to consider in shaping the plan. And I will promise you, when we show up next year, the plan will be different, because we'll be evolving it and moving it and shaking it all the way around this year, and then we'll come up and give you the latest update of what we have. And maybe the last thing, someone said, is this the right timing to have the discussion? It's the right timing to have a discussion, because we're not proposing any build-out of any particular new generation. We have more generation currently than we need, so this is a good time to start the conversation about what our possibilities are, so we can talk about it before we make any formal decision going forward. And the timing, we're really excited because, yes, we did, and we are absolutely committed to the climate action work, and that is a huge input, and we are stepping up that, and the public input is ramping up on that. And so those are going to be connected to ultimately what we do, and we are just in conversation in creative space. So that's the way to start. So I think I'm going to get help, I think. I don't see maybe this one. Nope, maybe. Is that it?
There
okay. Here we go. So I got it. Technology. I'm going to tie in a bit about kind of some events and things that we've done. We think it's really important to have a dialogue. We think it's really important to ask more people to help us think about the solutions and activities of what we're doing. And we think the thought leadership and the views of what we want our community to be today and the future are really a part of this thought leadership that really belongs to all of our community. So I'm going to link the thought leadership concept to the Flexible Path Plan. We had a conference. It was the second annual Future of Energy Symposium. We had last year's symposium at St. Mary's. This year we had it at Texas A&M University San Antonio. Dr. Cynthia Teniente-Manson was our host. And the point was, we went to their beautiful campus and we invited leaders, those leaders you see there, to come in and let's have a dialogue about the broad aspects of energy. And so we had Dr. Cavanaugh came in, and he has been studying the energy industry for decades. And there was a good conversation with him about there are so many parallels to energy and the different things that the energy industry has benefited from. One of the major things he focused on is that the effort broadly about energy efficient appliances that have been running regardless of what's happening in the energy industry have in fact helped everyone with conservation, and we think that to a great degree is why, in part, that our conservation program, the STEP program, has been so successful. So he kind of talked about it from the creation and also from the aspect of policy has been important. In the case of appliances, it's been federal policy, but I think he really also put it to us that local policy is also helpful as we start to think about solutions and really putting together what we can do as far as being good operators and services of the community, and then aligning those messages to the things that the community wants and what we get from input from everyone and through the council. So that was his major point. We also had Dr. Masoud Amin. He's a professor at Minnesota University, and he has been basically, he helped found the concept of improving the grid. It's important that we improve the grid digitally. The analogy is, you know, years ago I was in the cable business. In the cable business, they had converter boxes that were analog boxes. You couldn't do anything unless you walked up to them and moved the slide rule. Well, that's old technology. Now we have digital technology. Whether or not you get more channels, is that good or bad? But the real content issue is you get content through your cable box. Now you can get streaming content on your phone or on the computer. But moving the technology along to enable changes is what's really important. And he has been the one that has really helped us think about improving the grid and thinking about ways to optimize it and move our energy solutions forward. So he came in and helped talk about that. Clint Vance, he is a global thought leader in terms of energy. And ultimately, I am joining his effort and thought leadership. There's a think tank about smart city, and we in San Antonio is identified as a global opportunity for smart city, and so we're going to be able to get more people to help us contribute to the city's goals about what smart city could be, and so we're excited about that. And Dr. Atticott from St. Mary's University, a local talent, talked to us about the security that has to come along with all of this enablement. It's great to have new technology, but you got to think about the security at the same time. And then Mr. Hassan Ophir Osan, the last person there, also isn't a security expert. So, you know, I think it was a landscape to say that you could, you know, we had a morning session and people came in and out. I told them that we could talk all day about energy solutions because it's multifaceted and there's a lot of things going on. But really, this community, we'll be talking about this on into perpetuity because there are just so many meaty things for us to think about that we can shape. And so we are committed to doing that seminar every year, but at the same time, we will do our immediate outreach because this is a community that we love and serve, and we will open up this dialogue so we can continue to make our solutions very robust. These are a couple of pictures. I don't need to go through them, but I will say that we also were able to get the mayor to come in and talk about the broader solution set and then the connection again to our ability to have a focus on climate, our ability to integrate solar, our ability to think about broadly the quality of life that goes along with the programs that we can generate. So we had a really nice non-fireside chat, fireside chat. So we had no fire. So those are those pictures. So here we go. So in realizing all of those things that we need to think about, like what are the possibilities? Where can we go? That's a very fluid conversation. What I'm showing you here, though, is a chart that you've seen before. I've been in several months ago and start talking about. So what we're doing is we're optimizing the assets that we currently have. We have $11 billion in assets, right? The majority of the assets are in the existing generation fleet. We have all different types of ability to produce power, and I'll talk a little bit more about that today. But we have investments in the transmission business, we have investments in the distribution business, and we manage the relationship with the customer. So we have all that. The absolute reality of where we are today is our diversification strategy works. We have been able to meaningfully introduce a large segment of wind, over 1,000 megawatts of wind, 500 megawatts of solar, and more to come, very much so. But what we also do is we do it in concert, and we level it out, and we're able to balance and optimize the operation of the generation we have for the new renewables with our existing plants. And so our existing units help firm up the power that we have today and make sure that that power is reliable. That reliability and affordability are huge, huge requirements that are our obligation. So that anytime this community wants to operate, and it's a 24/7 community, we've got to be there to turn that power on. But it's in combination. So one side of the chart says, the way we shore up renewables and optimize them today is with the existing fleet. And because that has always been well managed, we've been able to insert wind and solar in a very reasonable way, pretty fast over the last 10 to 15 years. And again, more to come. What we really believe is that in the future, it won't be the fossil generation that will firm up renewables and optimize the fleets. It'll be new technologies. And in general, we just say energy storage. It's not just batteries. There are new chemistries coming out. There are flow batteries and just all different technologies that are being really researched and developed across this globe that we are studying. And we believe the ability to have a concept of a separate renewable source along with renewable energy will be the future. The real question again, and we've talked about this before, is how fast will that be? How fast will the energy storage show up in an economical way to make it work? And everybody's working on it, and we are monitoring it. And we're going to do this year a project where we really delve into the combination of renewables and energy storage. We are very close to finalizing the deal. That we had to work out the specifics, but Southwest Research Institute is partnering with us with a major microgrid project. It is 10 megawatts of 1 hour storage or 5 megawatts of 2 hour duration storage. But the point of it is right now, while the economics are starting to get better, we're gonna improve our abilities to manage those assets. We're gonna improve our ability to monetize the actual asset investment and really figure out the best way to really bring value back to this community. And we're not waiting for it to be sure, we're not waiting for the price to get down to some particular level. We're venturing into it because it's the right investment into the future of where we're headed. This basically talks about why flexible really works. Again, there's still a requirement on the traditional side to make sure that we are serving the load, that we have to do that today. That we are accommodating growth. We want more rooftop solar, more community solar, and more of that is to come. And that happens through our conservation program. We also have, it was pointed out to me, Paula, you didn't talk about demand response. We have one of the best demand response programs in the nation. 200 megawatts really happens from our customers contributing to bringing down their demand at peak. That's what we ask them to do when it's really hot or really cold. Bring your demand down so we're not overtaxing our system. The real important point is not about how we operate today, but if we keep letting our peak go up and up and up, it'll drive us to make us make an investment sooner than we need to. That's the whole thing. We haven't had to build a plant. I've been at the facility, at the business for 13 years. The original plan said that right now we would have a new fossil fuel plant. And with this conservation program, we have pushed that way out to maybe never will we build a 1,000 megawatt fossil fuel plant. And we think that's a reality. But it's because we have the STEP program that is helping us do that. And is there more potential in the STEP program with other expansions of demand response and other things? Yes. Now, I'm glad to say, glad to have a dialogue about it, but I want to make sure that we understand we're doing some amazing things here. And we continue to look at renewables. We will add them. The point is, I got asked maybe about a month ago, Paul, are you going to add more renewables today? We're not adding renewables today, not because we don't think renewables are good. It's because right now the community is doing great in conservation. The community is taking advantage of the assets that we currently have. So we will make additional investments in renewables. It's just timing. It is not, we are fully committed and we are fully open to do that. So this is why we think we have to keep the community's powder dry, because more options will be coming along and it'll be the right opportunity and we will make those investments at those times. So I'm not going to belabor this. This will be posted on our website and anyone can look at it. And then when we go out into the community, we'll explain it more and go through it. To run a model, so we're an engineering analytics firm. To get to these things, we have to run models. And so basically we said, let's run a model that does something different than what we normally have done. To run this flexible path plan as a model, and there'll be different versions of that, but this is the key one that we're focused on for strategic purposes. We made some major thought about, what if we shut Spruce Head 2 down earlier than we would have normally done? That will keep us from making certain investments in the future in terms of environmental control, and we can use that money on something else. Now, we won't have the production, so we wanted to run it through the model to figure out what would that be like. We also said, let maybe we don't extend the life of gas plants. We did that. We shortened it, and this was a technical shortening, not a declaration or an overcommitment. It was just an assumption to say what would happen. And so we ran all of these things. We put in there, what if we had battery storage in terms of what we know now? And then we said, ultimately, the real aspect of that is we ran that model, and then we said, well, how do we evaluate it? We'll evaluate every option in terms of both the qualitative things and the benefits that we get in the community, and we'll also do a quantitative relationship. The fact of the matter is, and we've talked about this before, gas prices are cheap, gas is less emitting, and so what we'll be looking for are solutions that beat gas, either because qualitatively they're better, quantitatively better, or both. But gas is the generation type to beat. And we want people who are doing new advancements in research and technology to try to make it as economical and as affordable as possible over the long term. Prices just come down over the long term. And so we want them to say, hey, make it operate as good as a gas plant. If it's got zero emissions and it's the same price, we're gonna go to the renewable every time. If it's got no emissions and it's slightly much more, then we're still gonna look at, hey, what we got bigger benefits on the other side that are qualitative. But at the same time, we can't not encourage people to bring prices down. That's what we want, because affordability and reliability and resilience and 24/7 operation are all the things that we owe this community over time. So this is probably the first chart that caused a lot of consternation. But again, this is not a declaration. This is not a final. This is not, we have no flexibility to do anything else. But it is a view. So in the far left-hand corner, that's what we look like today. And I also got some input recently, because if you look, we have a lot of fossil. A lot of it is in gas, and that's intentional because it's half the emissions of coal. And the question I got back today and the suggestion was, well, Paula, you're forgetting to really put what it looked like 10 years ago. It's a different view of that, where you had coal, and then the gas now that's dark blue, right back then, about 10 years ago, that was all coal. And it wasn't low-emitting coal either. So we have been making a journey. We have reduced our emissions tremendously, and we are on a journey, a plan to get better and better over time. But that first column is how we look. The second column is, if we use the same strategy, that we're an owner-operator, we can build. We can build a fossil plant, a gas plant, probably that's kind of the margin. If we did that, that's what it would look like. And I would say, increase your gas generation production. But we said, well, why don't we try something else? And so the last column is a view of, what if you just didn't replace those gas plants with more gas? What if you said, we're going to take a bet that potentially, instead of replacing it, there's going to be some aspect of a PPA or some other opportunity to insert renewables. And so we finally get to where we have maybe a smaller 20% fraction of renewables and solar, and now we say it's at least 50. It's at least 50. And this is conceptual. That's it. it can definitely be bigger. And we will look at new technologies, and we will look at our opportunity to expand that. I think what we've seen some social media, and we've got some input, and we've seen some headlines, and the headlines have said, yes, but there is still coal, and you probably could see it better, in the future. But the thing I want to highlight is we got to do some more analysis. We got another bit of suggestion that says, just take in mind, though, that you're growing. So let's look at absolute terms and not just relative terms. So we will do that. We will come back and insert that and say that's what absolute terms looks like. If there's more people moving here, then in absolute terms that would go up technically. And so we will present to the community what that total would be by impact. So that is true. But relatively, I want to point out the ratios decline. They don't. So quite frankly, nuclear is not currently declining. That whole facility has served this community very well. It is non-emitting, and it is well-run, and it's cost-competitive, and it helps our community tremendously with reliability and resiliency. So yes, that is in the plan. But who knows? We might not get a license. The next license coming up, things could change. But that is currently what we know and believe will happen today. But I will point out the gray that is causing this initial, concern, that is just how we see it now. But really, if you look at where the gray starts and where the gray ends, it's almost negligible. And so we are not overbetting. There's one plant existing out there by that time. It's the newest plant. The community is paid for it. It's committed to it. And it's producing value. But we won't lock in at that. If there's some other way to either change the emissions, the technology, or shut it down, and that's the best option at the time, we stay ready to do that. But what we think is really critical is look at the opportunity on the other side. The growth in the renewables really increases. The growth in new technology really increases. And we believe that aspirationally, and really even more so, we think that's a real picture, and things can just get better from there. And whether or not we make a commitment that we want to be 100%, this is not discounting a commitment and an aspirational goal to be 100%. We're an engineering analytics firm, and we're trying to create an action path to move forward. And so all options stay on the table, all aspirations stay on the table, and we are there to help this community apply those solutions going forward. So what happens is, what we don't know when we grow forward is, I always like to give the analogy of, we used to have to incent light bulbs. We used to have to spend a ton of money buying light bulbs and handing them to people because nobody wanted to change from the light bulb. People said, it's a different light, it's not bright enough, it's not good, it's too expensive. But that's what these programs do. They initially help us encourage to change behaviors, and now we don't have to incent buying light bulbs. People just buy light bulbs and they buy the new technology, and people are happy. So in the pathway, we're not sure things, but we do feel like things will happen. And we think there will be more DG, and we think prices will come down. And so if there's more distributed generation across the system, that also says we don't necessarily have to build big plants, and we recognize that. And we are not sunk or locked in to say that we've got to be the only suppliers. We're going to be open. And what we really think we're going to do is be value-add drivers. We're going to manage the grid. We're going to make sure that as power is produced, it'll move back and forth. People will probably even broker. And so what's key is electric vehicles will change the world, right? You drive up now and you go to the gas station, you pump gas in, and that's all good. And that's all we've known for our entire lives, and we've been a nation of drivers with gasoline. But electric vehicles will change the world. The interesting thing is your car today does not fill itself up, right? But with electric vehicles, it can charge up. It can put power back on the grid itself. And there will be times where we want to buy that power. And so it's going to change everything. And in our community, because we are totally aligned to the city of San Antonio, our owner, and we serve the community, we want to solve that problem and that opportunity together. Because we feel like that's the right place for us to do and the right place for us to move forward. So right now it's slow growth in EVs. but they predict that Australia as a country, for example, will be in EVs on the next 20 to 25 years, and that the United States will be somewhere in that pact as well. And now you're starting to see manufacturers talk about full EV lines. They're not even going to produce a gas-powered plant. I mean, a car. You start to hear that there'll be no more diesel. These things are coming, and technology is actually driving them, and the new offerings are going to change how we do it. And again, this is an opportunity for us. I did want to point out, and you have council members have this chart in front of them, and we will post this as well. I just wanted to say, we actually have 146 EV charging stations across the city now. And they're available, and that's our foundation. And we have more charging stations than we have cars to charge. And that's okay, because eventually it'll flip. And we will need to have more charging stations out for it. And we're going to do a strategy on that. Now, the one thing I will highlight, we do have an entrant into our system who is not yet partnered with us. And they're putting a charging station and charging a premium price for that. We are supportive of new businesses, and we want to make sure that the community gets the services that they want. But we're going to need to partner with them and make sure that they are doing it with the permission of the city. In terms of, are we going to have any permitting requirements for EVs in general? We need to align to that strategy. And we need to partner, and we need to make sure that our customers are paying a fair price for that energy. So we expect to build this out, and we will come forward and talk about our possibilities of building out more in terms of EV possibilities and what new investments we want to make. And we definitely want the council's input, and we will also talk to the community about that as well. This is just a current slide of the 146 where they are currently. And this is the comment about the current unauthorized provider. I do want to highlight again, we're telling a story about a vision and a path with lots of potential and lots of flexibility, but we're also doing real things. So I want to highlight, we did launch another roofless solar, another community solar project. We did an RFP for up to 5 megawatts. We are currently, the submissions, we got good response to our request for proposal, and we expect to actually go through the process and award that at the new 5 megawatts by the beginning of the summer. And we're excited about that because more community solar is really good for our ability to really modulate and keep demands from fossil fuel generation down. And we will do more and more and more of that over time. This is our time frame. This is by the early summer. And that is my highlight for what I want to talk to you today. And if you have any questions, I will answer those.
Great. Thank you, Paula. Bringing this one to council quickly, because it was just presented to the board on Tuesday. Just to set the context for the discussion, and we'll get immediately into council commentary, to emphasize the slide where it showed the energy mix now, 2040, and then 2040 flexible. The idea there is that this is based on what we know today.
Absolutely.
All conditions remain the same. And our ability to produce renewable energy and the resources we have currently allocated towards new technology and innovative solutions like storage capacity. That's important for you all, and you've done a great job, your team, in providing us the facts, the environmental conditions, not just natural resources, but the environment and the ecosystem of utility costs and production variables, to understand the world as we know it and the track that we're headed towards. It's a good one because, as we all remember, it's a much different track than we would have been on had SA 2020 not taken place and the community provide very good direction for the city to become cleaner, more renewable, more efficient, and so forth. So the discussion at the boardroom for CPS is not entirely different, but it's more nuanced and has more gravity in this room. For this reason, CPS is a municipally owned energy utility. That means that the public are our stakeholders, not private corporation. That provides us an opportunity as a city to be leaders, to bake in our values into how we do business, and to emphasize where we want to place investments, whether it's to be a cleaner city, to be a greener city, to be a healthier city, and at what cost we would do that, and to balance the needs of our energy utility to remain affordable to all members of our community, because we know that that's an extraordinary issue. That's the balancing point that's going to be difficult for us to determine without going into the community, having conversations like this in many different rooms and with many different constituencies. I will say firmly that I am grateful for the work that you all have done to provide the very important stable force that CPS Energy has been for our community, and to basically keep not just the lights on, but the parks clean and trains running and all the other things that the city depends on you for, because it is a portion of our revenues that we do everything operationally at the city. But I'm also of the mind that we need to set aspirational goals as a community, and where on the horizon we should be if we do bake in our values as a community in 2040. Is it no coal? Is it 65% renewable? Is it some mix of the above? I believe we need to push the envelope, and we need to determine how we get there. This country, I remember 20 years ago, one of the biggest political issues was how do we become energy independent? And you can debate whether or not we actually got there, but many people will say that we're certainly closer than we ever have been. We would never have gotten there if we accepted the world as it was back then. It took some political leadership to say that we wanted to get there. So that's what I'm asking today, is to be cognizant of that, understand how far, to Councilman Blythe's point, how far CPS has come at the direction and the cooperation of the community, but also where we want to go. Is it 2040, which is remarkably better than I think most publicly owned municipalities or privately owned municipality or privately owned utilities might be, or is it farther? I think we can do better. We also have to determine where those investments will need to be made and at what cost. So I don't have any questions at this point, but I'll turn it over to my colleagues, starting with Councilwoman Sandoval.
Excuse me. Let me get my cup real quick.
Thank you, Mayor, and thank you, Paula, for your presentation. I apologize that I was late. I had to celebrate International Women's Day. I do want to echo the mayor's comments that because we have a municipal utility, we have a wonderful opportunity to direct our energy future. We have more leverage than we would if we were a for-profit, or if you were a for-profit entity, right, and we weren't involved. And it is true, our stakeholders are our residents. There's the ratepayers, your customers, but also the people who own it. We're your extended board, I guess. And I appreciate the work that you and your team have done thus far. I've been very impressed with how open you've been to the suggestions that we've given you, and that, you know, I have pushed a little bit when it comes to renewable, like why is it only, you know, such a small percentage, and what kind of storage do we need to reach that target that we want? So thank you very much to Chris. And for also beginning to consider the environmental impacts associated with the purchasing that you do. We know that pollution doesn't only exist at the power plant or at the point of combustion, but all the way up the supply chain as well. We talked about how coal is, you know, mined. It travels on open trains, and where, you know, many people along the way are affected, and their health is impacted as well. So I do have one quick question. In terms of the 2040 traditional or flexible plan, if there is coal at that point in time, can you remind me which is the plant that will be operating?
Spruce 2.
Spruce 2. And is Spruce 2 operating with SCR right now? Okay. So Spruce 1 would be the one that you would remove in 2030? Okay.
Yes.
Great. That is really the only question I had right now. Thank you very much, Paul.
And maybe I would comment. Councilwoman was nice enough to meet with Chris and myself, and we do check-ins again, and we talk to everyone. But we had a good conversation about principles, and I say that because we really haven't talked a lot about it, but we have recently created some principles in terms of what we want for purchasing, and we're flashing to the potential vendors. We want to understand what they're doing in terms of sustainability through the entire value chain of what they're delivering us. I again remember when I entered the industry about 10 years ago, there was this thing called carbon principles, and they were out there for all investors to look at. And they are not rigid. They are aspirational and appropriate. But the real thing is to start to get the suppliers to start talking to us about what are they doing, where are their commitments, where are their investments, and start the dialogue. And then ultimately, I think we can start thinking about how does it really influence the final decision, but we are really trying to put out there, so when you come to San Antonio to deal with us, that part of what you're doing is important, and we're gonna start monitoring all that and building it into the things that we're doing on the Clean and Climate Action Plan and just the way we wanna operate. We just wanna change our DNA to be thoughtful and getting others to be thoughtful. And so thank you. You actually gave us that thought and idea when we were meeting with you. And so we have a preliminary principle statement out there, and it'll evolve over time, and we will share it with everyone.
Thank you, Bob. I'm going to add one more comment. Mayor, I am jumping up and down inside of me, and that's what I told Chris the other day. I know you can't see it, but I am. I'm just so excited about that. And I also just wanted to let everyone know that about the event on March 19th.
Yes.
You could go ahead and tell the details, but the really exciting thing is we aren't waiting for the climate action plan to be done before we begin implementing reductions in greenhouse gases. So this is an example, this sniffer test that we're going to do in a couple of weeks is an example of a greenhouse gas mitigation measure. I know that sounds like a mouthful, but it's something that reduces pollution while saving us money and protecting our health all at the same time. So to any naysayers out there about the climate action plan, those are the types of solutions that we're looking for. Increases in quality of life, saving us money, reducing pollution, and protecting our health. So please tell us that.
Okay, well, very good. So we're a dual energy provider, right? We're producing electric and we're producing gas. And so we have a gas system with huge investments. And we've done some studies about technology that is out there. We typically have our ability to detect if there is any type of problems in the infrastructure. And you know, we go survey it, or a customer might call us, they smell something. But there's new technology where you can have a mobile unit that goes and drives through the community to look for things well before our noses would tell us something. And so in reality, anything that would actually be a breach, like a crack or something in the gas system, is actually much more toxic in many ways than the air emissions issue. So we actually think this is one of the best investments in terms of environment that we can make. And so we have bought what we call the smart sniffer. And it actually is a parallel. We're going to make it look like a dog. And we want to do some education with kids, and we want to talk to them about what it really means to think about the environment in terms of practical solutions. And it's powered by Picaro. It's kind of the developer. But that's the beginning of trying to find these real practical solutions that look for ways for us to make our community cleaner, better, more effective. And again, Councilwoman Sandoval has agreed to help us do the promotion with that and get it launched, and then figure out where additional investment opportunities really align with the climate action plan that she's helping lead.
Great. Thank you, Councilwoman Sandoval. Councilman Courage.
Thank you, Mayor. You mentioned a little while ago dialogue being important. And I'd like to ask, is the board agenda for the Board of Trustees published under some kind of guidelines or schedule so the general public knows what that is?
Yes, well, we have meetings every month, and you know, the standard meetings aren't every month, they're usually the last Monday of the month, and then we post the activity for the next month. We post it in the week before. And so, and we actually post it through the city's method here, so publicly can be attained.
How about the recent meeting you had that wasn't a regularly scheduled meeting? Was that able to be posted ahead of time?
We actually post all, anytime we have a quorum, which is more than two board members. So committee meetings are just committee meetings, and they don't take any board action in those meetings. But with any time you have three or more board members, that agenda is posted publicly.
Do you have citizens to be heard at those meetings?
We do not have citizens to be heard because we go out and do our own outreach and just, you know, make ourselves available. Our board members make themselves available. They respond to inquiries as well. So we do not have a section for that.
Okay, you do have a citizens advisory board.
We do have a citizens advisory committee.
Did they have a chance to see this plan yet?
We have not shown him that those specific plans, but we have shown them all the components of those plans.
Okay. On a different item, I understand that the city of Georgetown and some other cities have gone all renewable. Mm-hmm. Now, how can they do that, but we can't?
Okay, great question. It kind of parlays to the comment. That's a declaration of commitment, and it's backed up by power agreements in the background that basically allocate renewable power fully to cover all the demand and load, which is a viable way to do it. But in reality, power is moving indiscriminately all across the grid all the time. As I always say, electrons love everyone. And so in reality, all the power goes in there. And they could be getting, and probably at certain times, like when there's storms and, you know, freezing and there's no sun and there's no wind, they're getting power from other units, but the grid is providing that. But because they have a contribution to support the renewable piece, their allocation is 100% covered.
Do they not generate power themselves?
No.
Okay, so it makes it pretty easy to say you're going to be all renewable if you don't generate anything from it. Okay, thank you. I had a question too. On the last page of the presentation, you say RFP.
Mm-hmm.
What is the purpose of the RFP? I didn't understand.
Oh, you're talking about this?
Yeah, your last page, tentative RFP. What is the purpose of that?
In our process, when we want people to bid on our activity, so we actually want a supplier to come in and build the community solar system, We did a request for proposal outreach, and we posted out there to let everyone do it. And along the years, we run into people, and they say, we might be interested in doing this service or that service, or they might be saying they do something. We ask people to register with us as much as possible, and we always encourage that. So if somebody registers and says, my business is a renewable business, we actually use that list, too, to say, here's some new business that you might want to bid on. But the process helps us really kind of put a definitive, we put out a scope, like we want, these are the specific things we want, meet or beat it, and then we are able to compare all of those things together, and that allows us to really kind of use an objective scoring ratio.
Well, I understood that concept, but I mean, what specifically are they putting an RFP for?
Actually have the right to create the community solar systems.
Okay, that was my question.
Yes.
Thank you. I wanted to thank CPS also for coming out to the neighborhoods and address some outage problems that we've been having in Deerfield and Inwood and in my district. And I also know that you're coming to North Central Thousand Oaks at the end of the month to kind of resolve those. And I know my constituents and I personally are very pleased to see that. The Inwood remediation project completed, which would improve reliability, but there were a number of other properties that needed tree maintenance, and most of them haven't been completed. So is that still part of?
So we have a plan overall.
We can give you an update.
I don't have it with me, but we'll give you an update and give you more specific dates on that.
Okay. Two other questions. Yeah. Will CPS participate in a future installation of 5G transmitters currently underway in Austin?
We don't have a program out there for that perspective. No, we do not yet.
So have you looked at the possibility or the benefit of those transmitters?
We are actually looking at our entire system in terms of fiber and connectivity and communication and augmentation to our smart city outreach. So we are looking at all of that. We don't have an actual project for that out there now.
Okay. One other question kind of about Deerfield. Deerfield has utilities underground.
Mm-hmm.
Will poles be required, and where would they generally be installed in any correction of problems in that area? And why can't we go more to just underground installation? Why can't we get them all up out of the air and under the ground?
Well,
like,
sorry.
We're doing cable. Yeah.
A couple of things. I don't believe that we really are looking to take any of the infrastructure there from underground above. I mean, it would have to be some unusual situation, and we would talk to the area, and that wouldn't be our approach, and no one's talking about
okay.
that. But we'll update you.
So
I don't
it's underground,
even know
it'll probably
out.
Stay
it'll
underground.
Stay.
Yeah.
So a couple things. Usually, and we've heard this, and we are actually starting up a communication with the development community. And we were actually looking at it solely from our standpoint. Again, when you put in underground, particularly when you retrofit underground, that's one thing. Think about it this way. So if we want to go from aerial to underground, we're going to have to rip up a ton of streets and really change the traffic and patterns. It's very disruptive and it's very, difficult, just qualitatively. Quantitatively, it's just really expensive. And so we didn't plan or put in the infrastructure cost to the community a fully undergrounded system. We do everything we can every year not to come forward to request money, but if we move to we need to put everything underground, that bill would be tremendously high. And again, as $1 million a mile, and we cover, this is not linear, but we cover 1,500 miles, right? So just, we can come back and give you some more calculations, but we haven't done it in many reasons because of the affordability. The other issue is there's a lot of, when you put it underground, it seems great, but also when you put it underground, it goes bad, it's really hard to fix. And so the repair on it is very, very difficult. We've tried some other techniques where we would actually have what we call direct bury. You don't put it through a conduit. And some of the fibers like that, they're just directly putting it in the line with no conduit or very simplistic conduit. For our infrastructure, we need very broad conduit to be able to sometimes pull the lines and do the repair and then put the line back in there. But we tried in some places a couple of decades ago to do what we call direct bury. When we did that, you don't think about it, but the ground is always shifting because we have extremes in heat, and now we have extremes in cold. That direct bury actually makes the infrastructure more fragile. And so while it does make it look more beautiful, it doesn't necessarily, it actually increases the cost and the maintenance and those activities. That said, I would say that we are still open to try to do direct bury in the most strategic places possible. So sometimes based upon the area and where we're at, and if it's if it's just deemed to be the place that we need to invest more effort, we will go back in and either retrofit or build out the underground. And so we still have options. And actually the last piece is we will have to also work with the developers, because their comment is when we have to go in and do all of that infield production and it's not in our rates, it just makes the project more expensive for them. And that's a big deal on their economics. But we have started that conversation to figure out how can we come up with a balance. We can definitely, and we know it's a hot topic, we can keep talking about it. What can we do to get better? We will do that. We'll come back.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Councilman Kurtz. City Manager Scully would like to provide some additional.
Just to add to your question about undergrounding utilities, some cities have ordinances that require any new development to incorporate undergrounding of utilities on major and local streets as a cost of development. And some cities have had those policies in place for now 30 years or more. So think about the growth in San Antonio, and if all of that new development that's happened over the past 30 years had been undergrounded. And so it's something perhaps as a policy matter for the council to consider as we talk about any amendments to the Unified Development Code that will be coming up for consideration. Paul and I have had considerable conversation about the undergrounding because of power outages that we've had in the community with storms and certain areas of the city being affected more so than other areas. So I think it's a worthy conversation for the council to consider.
Agreed. Thank you, Cheryl. Councilman Wise.
I think that it's important, and you and I talked about earlier, that you know when people look to leaders to make important decisions, they're expecting those leaderships to those leaders to understand and communicate where we've been, right, where we are, and where we're going. And they've done an excellent job today of showing us where we're going, right? And I'd asked you earlier, we need to spend some time on making sure everybody understands the difference between what CPS is today versus what CPS was 10 years ago, 20, 30, 40 years ago, right? Because the advances you've made, you know, your predecessors.
All my predecessors.
Right.
Yeah.
Are not to be taken lightly, right? And we on the city council have been getting nonstop barrage of the same email over and over and over again with different signatures, but it's the same email. And so let me read you something that this email contains. You tell me when you start to disagree with what it says, okay? You stop me. CPS Energy has shown real leadership on clean energy over the years. It was an early adopter of wind energy. It has made significant investments in energy efficiency and local solar through its STEP program. It set up a 400 megawatt solar goal and brought solar manufacturing to San Antonio. So far, we're on the same page.
Okay.
All right. But this new plan, your energy plan, misses an opportunity to continue the history of leadership.
Stop.
Okay. Why?
Because we haven't locked anything out.
Okay.
And we are going to continue to be innovative. And there is no declaration to do anything other than keep improving.
Right. So
we're not going to miss an opportunity. That's why it's flexible.
Okay. And that's the point. By the way, this was a Corey Brown.
No, I had no idea what you were going to read. I've been reading all this morning as well.
And so I have, and it's the flexibility that I want to point, you know, out, right? It's flexibility that got us from these huge double-digit percentages of how much coal we were using in this, you know, energy mix to us being on the very, very cusp of single digits then, right? And I think that the other part of leadership is also explaining to folks that we can't let the perfect be the enemy of the good, right? And boy, we got a lot of good. And we're all striving to perfect, right? And we're trying to get there, but, you know, not recognizing how good we are today is a lost opportunity. And so I will remind folks that, you know, as much as I would like for us to be fossil fuel free, right, and to have that as a goal, and I do have it as a goal, right, the reality is that, you know, that sign that somebody's holding up back there, think globally, coal is wrapped in plastic, which happens to be a fossil fuel product, right? And you didn't have an alternative material to wrap it in order to keep it dry and, you know, whatever, because an alternative material doesn't exist. All these folks showed up today because they all sent each other emails on computers made of plastic, which happened to be, you know, fossil fuel products, you know, energized by a utility that you know, uses a little bit of coal. And so it's really kind of impossible to divorce ourselves from the reality of the universe in which we live. And certainly these goals are laudable. And so I do want to point out that I think it's also really important that we understand that we aren't in this tiny vacuum, right? And again, I wish San Antonio was easy to wrap my arms around so that we can have laboratory conditions and know that, you know, whatever we put in, we're going to get out and anticipate, right? So that I don't have to see flexible in your plan. I want to know exactly what I'm buying today, what I'm going to get tomorrow. And so I keep thinking about how, by the way, I always talk about my kids, right? So I keep thinking about my kids and the law of thermodynamics. And in this instance, you know, I keep thinking about my son's room. He's 11 years old, but his room looks like a disaster. And, you know, but it left to its own devices, you know, everything that gets more use, everything that grows, everything that changes becomes less ordered, and my kid's room is less ordered. And so is San Antonio, right? We're getting more and more complex. We've got large energy consumers now telling us, hey, maybe we don't need to buy your energy, right? We've got people detaching from homes. Or, you know, we've now got these companies out there making these very dense batteries that may require us to fundamentally change the way we do business. And that's just, that's thermodynamics. I mean, things change, right? And so to reverse the tendency of, you know, chaos in the face of change requires a lot of work, and it requires a lot of energy, and it requires, you know, really smart people, and it requires the trust of stakeholders to let you do that work and continue moving in the right direction. So thank you for doing all that hard work and for lifting, and thanks to all those people who showed up, and thank you for bringing the sign, you know, and holding us accountable, and thank you for being reasonable and working with us folks. That's it.
I would just add, we are, to some degree, it's great that it's people interested, because it's great input to know what people are passionate about. So we are listening, and as we can solve those solutions in the future, we're motivated because we have customers who, like you say, holding us accountable.
The day you can get my kid to clean his room, the day
is. Can't get my 22-year-old to clean his room. I'll be helpful.
Thank you, Councilman Blaise. Councilman Diagro.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Paula, for the presentation. A couple questions on this EV charging stations. I'm just curious, how do you determine where to put one of these charging stations? Or is it private and they reach out to you?
I think we strategically were trying to, you know, just get dispersion right, and we were trying to look at, like, schools. But actually, we're ready to, we didn't have a real plan. I mean, we just kind of listed kind of back and forth where we did that. But now I think is a good time for us to have a much more robust, you know, for the use of a plan to figure out what should we do and where should we go. So that we're going to come back and put some options in front of you.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. And how many employees does CPS Energy have?
About 3,100
plus. 3,100
plus.
I do want to just give you and the team kudos, especially those CPS Energy members who just got back from Puerto Rico and helping rebuild Puerto Rico and connect our community. I think it's another great example of how San Antonio is working with the community globally and where everyone can help. So thank you. Thank you, and thank you to the team members, I think.
We
are very, thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Councilwoman Villagran. Councilwoman Gonzalez.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you for the presentation. I have a few questions and regarding the presentation. And, you know, we did have members of the community send us questions. And so I was reading through them and seeing if I had questions at the same time. And I do have one question that was sent to me. How much of the projected peak demand is actually not San Antonio's demand, but that of other cities on the state grid? Why should San Antonio keep its polluting coal-fired plants open just to sell energy at top dollar to meet other communities' peak usage? So is that true?
Well, we are not, we do not target peak to cover an ability to go out and go into the open market just to sell the excess power. So that is not our goal or objective. We don't do that. What we do, though, is I would say anywhere from about 12, maybe at peak 15% of our total excess of our total sales actually goes out to the ERCOT market, about that much. And that's at various times. It kind of goes up and down. And so we do that because we have a lot more generation than we need, but we meet every single peak hour demand. That's our primary focus. We do have customers that we've had almost as long as we've been owned by the city. Small communities like Floresville, Castroville, Hondo, they basically have been with us for the long haul. So to cover them, we actually include them in the peak, but they also have paid in many ways, for generations. They've been with us long enough to have made those investments. And so that's our real management and our objective, but it is not in terms of the wholesale sales. But I'll say this. Wholesale sales are good because those net margins come back and reduce the cost requirements for the average citizen. So we actually make money on our ability to take that wholesale sale. It's not a give. They pay a good price for what we do economically, and that helps us actually keep costs down and helps us lower the bills. So there's goodness, and we would be glad to come out and in the community come to you and go through more detail. But it is not a game of us optimizing our megawatts to go out and sell them in the wholesale market. We are really focused on the commitments here. We do have some added smaller ones. Again, these are long-term customers or small contracts. And then the little bit that we do sell on top of that actually brings back money and helps to lower costs. And this is existing infrastructure. Your existing plants is how we make them more efficient. We're not going out. We will not make an investment to buy it solely for the purpose of doing wholesale sales. We do not do that. When we bought Rio, we bought it to slot and get rid of Beagley. But that's for our investment. And we just put it in the market temporarily until we are closing Beagley. But that is it. Our efforts are all targeted at serving the retail load.
Another question I have regarding or building on Councilman Kerr's question about underground utilities. I know that we have some really large bond projects coming in that are for streets in districts 3 and 5. Roosevelt is $13 million for a complete street project, and we know that there's a tax dot match in there somewhere, maybe to the tune of around $8 million. So would that justify burying lines? I mean, I feel like that was part of the project, was that we would redo CPS and SAWS, not CPS, but we would redo utilities. Is there an opportunity to redo those when we do those large street bond projects?
You want to time it first.
Yeah. So the projects repair whatever is underground when we do the bond projects, but it doesn't incorporate a budget to underground utilities that are overhead on the wires. So whatever is underground, we've been working together now for the past 2 bond programs so that all of the work underground, whether it's SAWS, CPS, and the private utilities, is done when we excavate for a road project. But it doesn't incorporate a budget to underground the utilities if they're overhead on wires, on poles.
I sure would like to see that. And perhaps for future bond projects, when we're doing that, I mean, I know it wasn't voted on by the in the bond, but it would make sense to do that. And I know that if it's a requirement for new communities, that it could also be a requirement for infill, even if we're doing the same projects. I know I had a project a couple of years back on in San Juan Homes, which was off of Sarsen Wyatt. It was a $30+ million project, and I thought, well, it's almost the same cost as a new neighborhood, so why couldn't we do underground utilities at the same time if the investment is significant enough? So I hope we can do that. And I recognize these items are already budgeted, but would it have to be done on a case-by-case basis? So, for example, the next bond program, hopefully there's large ones, hopefully there's a street project that's many multi-millions. We had one also that was a 2012 bond program on Beale and Malone, and that was in the neighborhood of $16 million. How can we include that? Cheryl, is that part of the language that has to be included in the bond? Or
it's the language, but it's also in the budget. So just as an example, we undergrounded the utilities at Broadway Hildebrand when we did just at that intersection. It was quite a maze of wires at that intersection. The decision was made collectively with the council to underground the utilities at that intersection with the drainage project. It added more than $2 million to the cost. So it becomes a cost factor. It's a policy issue if the council wants that considered it may mean fewer projects because they those that are done that are, they cost more to underground utilities.
Okay, well, hopefully that can be discussed at a later date when, next time when we have big bond projects. I was so proud of the work that was done with CPS in Puerto Rico. I mean, it's no different from what we did in Houston when they had big hurricanes there that we sent out a team. But I was really curious about who paid for that. What was the financial arrangement to send those?
So FEMA is still, they are working and doing the funding in terms of restoration now. And it's covering the majority of the work. It does not cover Chris's effort because he's on a technical advisory committee. Now, most of the stuff they do is teleconferencing and meetings and things like that. But we did host the day of Martin Luther King's walk and birthday, national holiday. They actually hosted people coming in. We called it a day off. And so that executive technical committee is doing the things, and we do that as part of our thought leadership perspective, but it is not a high expensive thing. He did make one trip so far down to Puerto Rico, very much got a lot of things done, including talking to the governor and the governor down there, many of the heads of the different departments and aspects of their government. And so we did that in like a 24-hour flip around. So we're being very, very conscious of the things that we do. And it's kind of, we repurpose some of our thought leadership work. Because ultimately, the things, there's many things. What's good for Puerto Rico will rebuild that economy. But if we really think about us being able to do some new applied solutions, again, we can do some new things down there that might not have been done anywhere in the nation. Then we could bring that thought leadership and those types of solutions into our flexible path plan to say, we saw it, did it down there, tested it, it works, we could bring those things here. So that actually really, again, aligns to where we're at. But the average worker that goes down there is currently being funded by FEMA. They have a limit, though, for how long they're gonna go out. It's gonna affect the whole project, and I think right now they're trying to get some more extension of time with FEMA, and we'll keep you updated if for some reason the funding changes.
Okay, thank you. And so I just, with that, I just wanted to thank you for the pilot program in District 5 for solar lighting.
Yes, ma'am.
In the alleys or in the on the rooftops. That continues to be one of the number one concerns from our constituents is lighting in the neighborhoods. And so that was very well received. And I know we had at least 30 people sign up that day, and looking forward to how many additional lights that we can do. So I'm always impressed with CPS's ability to go from doing incredibly innovative things like the stuff that you're doing in Puerto Rico, or like the new technologies and things that you're thinking about for the future, but then can bring it right back home to our neighborhoods where we know we need increased lighting in our alleys. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for your passion around the lighting project. You know, we've done some really creative things with lighting in your area that we are interested in actually, you know,